To give you the facts, the United States Air Force presents...
The United States Air Force has different codes for different type of incidents. Dull sword may be like a piece of support equipment that failed to function like it's supposed to. Nuke flash you don't want, because that's when the actual weapon has gone off. But a broken arrow is when there is actually damage to the weapon itself.
This is the stage for our story report. This is our protagonist, Minuteman, a new muscle in this country's armament of peace-preserving force.
Minuteman is a three-stage solid-fuel intercontinental ballistic missile that was deployed in the plains, North Dakota, Wyoming, South Dakota, Missouri, and in Montana. It was a way to replace the current liquid-fueled rockets. As with any liquid-fuel missile, it takes a lot of time and preparation prior to launch, whereas Minuteman is ready to go at a moment's notice. So it earned that title, Minuteman, from the Revolutionary War, Minuteman, because they were ready to go at a moment's notice.
3, 2, 1, 0.
What keeps our nuclear weapons safe? To understand why there has never been an accidental nuclear explosion, you must first know how these explosions can be produced.
Now, Minuteman just came out. It became operational in 63 for us here. And so in 1964, I think they were still going through the growing pains of trying to figure out who's going to take care of what systems. So general radio repair technician, that sounds like a group of folks that could take care of the security system. Well, I guess they found out the hard way. As I made rank and changed jobs, I was able to see the actual documents of the incident that happened. And so, yes, they used the improper tool. They used a screwdriver to pry a fuse out. On the launch facility, the outer zone security drawer has 4 sets of fuses in the top drawer. And part of the troubleshooting procedure was to, if you had an issue, was to go ahead and pop some of those fuses to check. Since they used a screwdriver, the drawer has capacitors which stores power. And so when they put that screwdriver in there, and they lifted that fuse, but they made contact with the case. That power went directly from the capacitor in the drawer to the chassis, straight through the ground, and caused the retro rockets to fire.
I was in my barracks at Ellsworth Air Force Base in South Dakota, and either doing laundry, which we typically did on Sundays, or playing pinochle in the day room. And I got a phone call, and it was my team chief saying, the missile doesn't have a warhead anymore. When we got there, there was a whole slew of people already there. My team chief met me and he says, we need to get the work cage put in. Do you volunteer to go down and safe the missile and take an EOD guy with you? Went on down to the bottom of the hole and inspected to find out what condition the warhead was in. And it was tore up pretty good, but it was in a safe enough condition that we could handle it anyway. And we headed back up and got back out of the hole and went back to report what we had found. The EOD guy explained what the condition of the weapon was in. And then he asked him, he says, how are we gonna get it out? And the guy just stood there, so I popped up and said, yeah, we'll take the cargo net that's tested for more weight than that weighs, roll it into it and get a crane and pull it out. And he looked at me and said, Airman, if I want anything from you, I'll ask for it. So I took that as an invitation to leave, and I went back and got the truck where it was warm. About a day, my team chief come to me again, and General wants to talk to you. He didn't say anything. The people at SAC headquarters started asking me questions about what the cargo net was weight tested at and all that. And they said, okay, that sounds like a doable idea. So 2 EOD guys got in a work cage. We trained them how to use it. And they went down to the bottom of the hole and took a cargo net with them, rolled the warhead into it, and brought it back up to the top.
Easy.
It was a very slow process. It was a little stop.
Okay. Hold it steady.
up a little, slow, slow, stop, up a little, stop.
Okay, hold it. Come on up slow.
Okay, come on up slow.
That process took hours.
Okay, come on, ease it down slow.
Okay, coming down slow.
When we got it to the top of the hole, I positioned the Army GMC van with the doors open and with a hoist extended out where we could transfer it from the crane into the Army GMC van. And my team chief comes to me again and says, Bob, you're going to have to drive the truck back to the base because nobody on the EOD team has got operator license to operate it. Told me maximum speed 10 miles an hour. So I said, okay. You know, we had a convoy behind us of ambulances, cops, and staff, and you name it. There was 20 cars or trucks behind us. And after a little while, I eased it up to 15 miles an hour just to find out if we got any communication. And we didn't. So we went a little while further, and I eased it up to 20 miles an hour. And I waited for some communication and didn't get any, so I bumped it up to 35, 40, 45 miles an hour. So we got to the base a lot quicker than 9 hours. And nobody said anything about it.
I'm sure if I was in that situation, I would be cleaning out my underwear. Because, you know, he's probably right. At the time, you just do it. I mean, we've all been there. We've seen situations where we just do it. Worry about the consequences later on.
It seems like that I've been in that position many times during my 43 years with the Air Force. And I've always told people, there was three people in that work cage. You know, my partner from EOD, myself, and God. So there was protection for us.